from Department of Mathematics, Gurucharan College, Silchar. We'll be beginning our lecture by Dr. Shantal Aishram from ISI Delhi shortly. We are waiting for our principal, sir, Dr. Vibhas Dev of GC College. And we also have our HOD, sir, Dr. Biplab Chaudhary, also with us. And so let us wait for some time.
Hello,
Biplab sir. I think it's audible now.
Hello.
Sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. We can hear you.
Audible.
Yeah, it's audible.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we have Dr. Biplab Chaudhary, who is the head of the Department of Mathematics, Gurucharan College. He is also there with us. He is also the president of the Assam Academy of Mathematics, Kachar District Branch. Okay, so let us wait for some time. We are waiting for our principal sir also to join. Yeah, and I let me also introduce Dr. Manjil Shoikia, who is the moderator of today's lecture. He is a postdoctoral fellow in Cardiff University, United Kingdom. He is a very active researcher and a very good friend of mine. So he will moderate today's session. So Manjil, if you want to say something to the participants.
Thank you, Devasis.
Yeah.
So welcome everyone to this webinar organized by the college and the Kachar district branch of Assam Academy of Mathematics and Gonitsura.
And Gonitsura, sorry, I forgot to mention that also.
So we are very happy that Dr. Shantal Aishram is with us. He is a very famous number theorist from India. I'm very happy to see that so many people have participated. So just 1 minute, I'll say a little bit about Gonitsura before the whole webinar starts. So Gonitsura was started by Pankaj Jyoti Mahanto and me in 2011. So Pankaj Jyoti Mahanto is also in the call as a participant. We are a dual language website in English and Assamese. So I encourage everyone to visit our website after the webinar give us suggestion or comments if you have any. We'd be very happy to hear back. So thank you. Devasis, over to you.
Yeah. Thank you, Mandeen. Okay, I would also like to request all participants to kindly mute their audio. Whenever you have any queries, you can just type them in the chat box, even in the comment sections of the YouTube streaming. The lecture will also be streamed in Facebook. I think, Manjil, you start streaming?
Yes, it is already streamed.
So, during the lecture, the participants are requested to keep their audios in mute mode so that the lecture can take place smoothly, and we will encourage the questions. So you can type in your questions in the comment section, and at the end of the session, we will take those questions to our resource person who will answer your queries. And at the end of the session also, if you are having any other doubt, you can just choose the raise hand option there is a raise hand option in Zoom. So you can choose that option, and if time permits, we can allow to have your question also.
Sir, you have any friend or type them in the chat.
Yeah, so our webinar is also live on Facebook. Yeah, okay, so the participants who could not join through Zoom can watch it in Facebook as well as YouTube. Okay, I also have an announcement to make. So at the end of the lecture, we will be providing the link to the feedback form. So the participants who have registered, they can fill up those feedback form, and after filling up the feedback form, e-certificates will be mailed to the participants. So it may take around 5 or 6 days to get the certificate because of some email restrictions. The certificates will be generated automatically. Okay, so but to get the certificates, one needs to fill up the feedback form. The link will be provided after the lecture. So in the meantime, I would like to request our head of the department, Dr. Biplav Choudhury, to kindly say a few words and maybe formally welcome our guest, Dr.
Chantalai. Good morning. It is my privilege to stand before you on this special day to hereby welcome you all in this first webinar program organized by Department of Mathematics, Guru Charan College, Silchar, India, in association with Assam Academy of Mathematics, Kachar District Branch, and Ganeshwara.com. This is a new trend to conduct lecture or seminar during this pandemic situation. So I invited Dr. Shantalai Sram, Associate Professor, Mastat Unit, Indian Statistical Unit Institute, New Delhi, to deliver a webinar lecture on the topic prime divisor in an arithmetic progression. We hope the deliberation will be very beneficial to different categories of participants, and we are grateful to Dr. Shantal Aishram sir being here with us. I again welcome you all and hope your active presence and interaction with the speaker will make this webinar lecture a great success. I especially congratulate Dr. Devarish Sharma, coordinator, for arranging this webinar program. Thanking you all.
Thank you, sir. Okay, so we are already on time. I'll just make a call to our principal, sir. I'll see if he is available, or else we'll begin our talk. Okay. Yeah, our principal sir will also join the link. Manjil, you can please have a look. I'll also have a look. Dr. Bibhash Dev from our principal sir. Yeah, he's there.
I have unmuted him just now, Devasis.
Yeah. Did you get him?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
I think he is in the call now.
Oh, okay. Hello, sir. Devasdev, sir. Sir, can you hear me?
His audio is not yet.
Okay. Yeah, he's already there in the list. Okay. Hello, sir. Bibhash Dev, sir. Audio is not audible, I think. No? Okay, I'll just make a call to him.
Thank you.
Yeah, hello. I think Vivek sir. Oh, you okay? Are you? Excellent. Manjil, are you being able to hear Vivas sir?
No.
No, sir. Suna jan na. Excellent. Just let me check. Hey, unmute.
Hello.
Yes, sir. It's audible. Okay.
Audible, na?
Yeah, yes, sir. Okay. So we have our principal, sir, Dr. Vibhas Dev, with us. So I'd like to request him to say a few words about our speaker, Dr. Pantal Ashram, and maybe welcome him formally. Sir, you can say.
First of all,
yes.
Good afternoon to all of you, all the participants, speakers, organizers. First of all, I welcome you all in this webinar organized by the Department of Mathematics, Gurucharan College. I hope it will be a grand success, and all the participants, all the students, and all the scholars will be benefited from this webinar. I express my gratefulness to the speaker, Dr. Shantal Ashram, for her respond to our call, and she will deliver her speech, and I believe it will be a very beneficial to all the participants, students, scholars. Finally, I once again thanks to all the organizers, all the resource persons for giving their valuable time in this webinar. With this, I hope this webinar will be a grand success. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. So, thanks a lot. So now we'll formally begin our talk by Shanta, sir. Everybody is waiting. So before that, I'd just like to read out his bio data. So I'd like to share my screen now. It's already there. I would also like to request everyone to kindly mute their audios. Okay, I'd like to request everyone to mute their audios, please. So this is a brief bio data of our speaker, Dr. Shantal Ashram, from Indian Statistical Institute, New Delhi. Yeah. So I think it's visible to everyone. Right. Dr. Shantal Ashram is an associate professor of mathematics in the Theoretical Statistics and Mathematics Institute, StatMath unit at Indian Statistical Institute, Delhi Center, New Delhi. He is a well-known researcher in number theory and cryptography. Dr. Ashram has an excellent academic record, and he has completed BSc Mathematics Honours from DM College of Science, Imphal, Manipur, in 2004 probably. And thereafter, he was awarded MSc by Research in 2000. So just sorry, it's not visible. Yeah. In 2004, by Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, TIFR Mumbai. He went into received his PhD in 2007, also from TIFR. And he has received several awards, including Microsoft Young Faculty Award 2010 to 11, Microsoft Research India and Indian Statistical Institute. And he has also received TAA Harishchandra Memorial Award 2008 for the best PhD thesis in mathematics at TIFR Mumbai. He has also received Kanwal Rekhi Career Scholarship during PhD program at TIFR Mumbai. He has also received Rajiv Gandhi Science Talent Search Research Fellow 1999 from JNCASR, Bangalore, India. His research interests include Diophantine equation, irreducibility of polynomials and inverse Galois problem, transcendental number theory and Diophantine approximation, prime numbers and cryptography, particularly the number theoretic aspects of cryptography. And Dr. Leishram has also been associated with lots of mathematics Olympiad activities in India and has been a resource person in several IMO, INMO training camps. He is also one of the associate members of the Mathematics Olympiads appointed by the National Board for Higher Mathematics, that is NBHM. So with this, I would like to welcome once again, welcome Dr. Shanta Leishram once again to our program, and I'd like to ask him to begin his session. Yeah.
Okay. Hello, thank you very much, Devasis, for your introduction.
Yeah,
okay. So first of all, I'd like to thank Gurcharan College, Assam Academy of Sciences, and Ganeshwara, particularly Manjit Saikia and Devasis for the kind invitation. And I hope today, hopefully, at least some of you will get to, get something new from my lecture. So I planned my lecture in such a way that I hope everyone should be able to understand. But anyway, please feel free to ask me if you have any questions or in between. By the way, so is my voice audible clearly?
Yeah. Yes, sir, it's audible.
Okay, fine. So now let me... Okay, so now...
Manjil,
Okay, so let me now start my talk.
Yeah, you can make it full screen, sir. Yeah.
So is my screen visible now?
Yeah, it's visible. But it is not in slideshow format, I think.
It's not in slideshow format. Okay, let's
see. Make it as a slideshow or presentation mode. You can open it in presentation
mode. Presentation mode now, right? Now is it coming?
But on the right side, I think... So you can just change one slide. Let us see whether the slide is visible.
Sir, if you can just do Command plus L key, if you can just press.
Yeah, Control L, I think. Yeah, Control L.
No, in Mac it is Command L. So.
Oh, yeah. Command L. Okay. He is using Mac.
I edited only. Just Command L only.
Okay. Oh, then I think in the share screen option, you have to choose the presentation, but there are several. I think the PDF is chosen only in the share screen Zoom.
Yeah, let me see. So
after clicking the share screen, you choose the presentation part. There will be two files open, I think.
Oh, okay. So presentation, let me see. Just desktop. Okay, this portion of the screen. Okay. So I've chosen, so let me see. So I've chosen my PDF file, so it's coming like this.
Oh, okay. I think it's visible. It's not a problem. So just try changing one slide.
So now I put it in the screen. So is it visible or still some issues?
Yeah, it's visible, but it's not in presentation mode. I think it will be fine. I think, Manjil, there is no problem, I think.
Yeah, sir, you can go ahead. It's not
a
problem.
Because when I share my screen, these things appear. So I open the file and it appears like this. So I...
It's okay, sir. You can go ahead.
Okay, all right. So thanks. So now let me begin my talks. So as you can see in my screen, what I'm going to talk today is on the prime divisors in an arithmetic progression. So I'm going to start with very basic information which all of us know. Okay, so yeah, I need to know about this presentation more. Anyway, somehow I. So let's start with a very well-known fact which all of us know. If you take any product of k consecutive integers,
sorry, sir, but the slide is not moving.
Yes.
The slide is not moving, sir.
It's not moving.
No, sir.
Oh, let me see.
Sorry, I think it is best if you just yes. Now it is moving. Yes.
Now it is moving. Yes.
Okay. Now it's moving. I see. Yes. Now it's fine.
Yes, sir. It's fine.
Okay. Fine. So then I'll put it like this. Okay. That's fine. So we all know that a product of k at least if you take consecutive integers then it's divisible by the k factorial where k is the number of that consecutive positive integers. So in fact, all of you know the binomial coefficient. So n choose k or the symbol which is written n choose k. That is the number of ways of writing. So number of ways of choosing k out of n possibilities. So we have a formula n into n minus 1 into n minus 2 up to n minus k plus 1 divided by k factorial. So we'll know that this is an integer. So this actually gives a proof of the fact that so on the numerator you have a number which is product of k consecutive integers starting at n minus k plus 1, n minus k plus 2 up to n. And denominator you have k factorial. So k factorial is an integer, so k denominator divides the numerator, which means k factorial divides the numerator. So k factorial divides a product of k consecutive integers. So this is the well-known fact which we all know. So basically it also tells you that every prime less than or equal to k divides a product of k consecutive integers. So this we know. Now we can ask, okay, you're given a product of k consecutive integers. Can you find a prime? So can you ask, okay, is there a prime which is bigger than k and which divides the product? So that is something which is worth asking. On this, what we know? So a very well-known theorem of Sylvester and Erdős answered this question. So Sylvester in around 1900, he proved this following result. If you take product of any k consecutive integers, each of which exceeds k, then that is divisible by a prime bigger than k. In other words, if you take any n bigger than or equal to k and take n plus 1, n plus 2 up to n plus k, so this is product of k consecutive integers. All of them are bigger than k because n is bigger than or equal to k. Then there's a prime. So capital P means the largest prime divisor of this product is actually bigger than k. So for any m, capital P of m means it's the largest prime divisor of m. So for example, P of 10 is 5 because 5 is the largest prime divisor of 10. And for convention, we just put P of 1 to be 1. So when you see that result, of course, it looks... Any questions? Okay. So this is a non-trivial result because when you see this result, okay, it looks very simple, but it's not actually trivial. That's because if I take n equal to 0, so if n is less than k, the result is not true. For example, if n is less than 0, n is equal to 0, then n plus 1, n plus 2, n plus k is k factorial. So you cannot have a prime bigger than k dividing the product. And one consequence of this simple looking, of course, this nice result of Sylvester is that it proves Bertrand's postulate, which tells you that given any k bigger than 1, you can always find a prime which lies between k and 2k. So it gives a very simple proof. Let me show you a proof. So if you take n equal to k, then from the fact that n plus 1 up to n plus k is divisible by prime bigger than k, so the number k plus 1, k plus 2 up to 2k, this is divisible by prime bigger than k. Now, if a prime divides a product of number, prime divides one of them. So that prime will divide one of k plus I. However, k plus I cannot be two, like it should be equal to that prime because two times that that prime will be bigger than 2k plus bigger than 2k, and that that won't be one of the terms. So that number which that prime divides itself will be that itself will be prime. So basically it tells you that one of these numbers k plus 1, k plus 2 up to 2k, one of these, at least one of these numbers will be prime. So that means there's a prime between k and 2k. This is what is given by Sylvester and Elders. So this is a non-trivial result. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to give a very elementary proof of this result and talk about generalizations and refinements. And I have prepared the talk in such a way that prepared this proof in such a way that all of you can should be able to understand it. So now let me give you start with some more remarks. So let P1 equal to 2, P2 equal to 3, P3 equal to 5, etc. be a sequence of primes. So you write P1, P2, P3, P4, etc. be sequence of prime. So P of M is the mth prime. And we denote by pi of m. So this counts the number of primes up to m. So for example, for up to 100, there are 25 primes. So pi of 100 is 25. And if you take the, okay, given any k, the least prime which is bigger than k is actually the pi k plus 1 prime. So pi k means primes up to k. P of pi k is the least maximum largest prime less than or equal to k. So P of pi k plus 1 is the least prime which exceeds k. Hence, what we can say is that if n is less than P of pi k plus 1 minus k, then product of this n plus 1, n plus 2 up to n plus k cannot be divisible by a prime bigger than k. So to have this product n plus 1, n plus 2 up to n plus k divisible by prime bigger than k, n has to be bigger than or equal to p of pi k minus k, p of pi k plus 1 minus k. If n is less than this particular number, p of pi k plus 1 minus k, then this is not true. So that way, the result of Sylvester and Erdos was non-trivial, and we cannot have n bigger than or equal to k by a very small number. So now my aim is to prove the result of Sylvester and Erdos. So let's start with the proof. So in my talk, I'm going to give a proof of that result of Sylvester and Erdos first, and later on, I'm going to talk about more generalizations. So the proof which I'm going to use is going to be completely elementary proof, which all of without any advanced mathematics, one should be able to follow the proof. So this is what is my M. So let's start with some first basic fact. So if I prove that the product of k consecutive integers is exceeding n, at least n bigger than or equal to k is divisible by prime bigger than k. So this means that the largest factor of this product is bigger than k. And suppose this result is true for every prime k, then it's true for all integers k. So that is the first lemma I'm proving. So once the result is true, so basically I need to prove for every, at prime values of k. That is the fact which I'm trying to prove. So let's try to see the proof. Suppose that a product of k, suppose that this result number, the display one, which is largest prime factor of n plus 1, n plus 2, n plus k, this is bigger than k for this is true for every prime, all primes k. Now you take a number k which lies between, given any number k, there are primes k1 and k2 such that k lies between k1 and k2. And k1, k2 are consecutive primes. Now take any number n bigger than or equal to k. So since k is bigger than k1, n is bigger than or equal to k1, hence by our assumption, n plus 1, n plus 2, up to n plus k1 has a prime factor bigger than p, bigger than k1. But the since k2 is the next prime, which is next to k1, so our prime factor p should be bigger than or equal to k2. And of course, k2 is also bigger than k by our assumption. Hence, this primes divides n plus 1, n plus 2 up to n plus k, and prime is bigger than or equal to k2, which is bigger than k. So hence, the assertion 1 is true for every k. Once it's true for all primes k, then it's true for every k, whether prime or not. So this is what this is the lemma which I just proved now. So because of this, to prove our result, that is to prove that largest prime factor of n plus 1, n plus 2, n plus k is bigger than k for all n bigger than or equal to k, we can just need to prove for when k is a prime. So we can forget non-prime values. Now again, we make one more substitution. We put x equal to n plus k. Then what we can see is that n plus 1, n plus k is nothing but x into x minus 1 up to x minus k plus 1. And not only that, x is at least 2k because x k n is bigger than or equal to k. So the 2 which we want to prove is equivalent to the fact that the largest prime factor of this binomial coefficient x 2's k is bigger than k, because a prime bigger than k won't divide k factorial. So the largest prime factor of this this expression x minus 1 x minus k plus 1 is same as the largest prime factor of x 2's k. So this is one substitution what we get. So therefore, now we're going to prove that largest prime factor of x 2's k is bigger than k for k prime and x bigger than or equal to 2k. So to prove the result of Sylvester errors, we just need to prove the display 3 which I have given here. And we're going to prove an elementary, by elementary methods without using higher advanced mathematics or without using prime number theory. So this is the M of the proof here. So we prove it by contradiction. So I want to prove that largest prime factor of x2's k is bigger than k. Suppose this is not true. So that means largest prime factor is less than or equal to k. Then largest prime factor x minus 1 up to x minus k plus 1 is less than or equal to k. This is what we have. So, and we're going to get some contradictions. First of all, let's start with a very important information of the prime divisors of binomial coefficient, which we require for the proof. So given x choose k, suppose p power a divides x choose k, then p power a is less than or equal to x. So that means take any binomial coefficient and take any prime divisor. So largest prime, so then power of any prime which divides that fact, that x choose k should be less than or equal to x. Now this follows from this observation that order of, so the largest power of p dividing x choose k is nothing but largest power of p dividing x factorial by k factorial into x minus k factorial. And by using the property that power of prime dividing a factorial is sum of x, the integral part of x over pl, where l runs from 1 to infinity. We can write this, the power of p dividing x to k is x by p power l minus x minus k by p power l minus k by p power l. But this, of course, the bracket denotes the greatest integer function. That means the largest integer which is less than or equal to this number. So that means largest integer less than or equal to x by pl, x minus largest integer less than or equal to x minus k by pl, etc. And it's an easy exercise to show that each of the sum inside is either, this is either 1 or 0. And one and 1 or 0 when l is bigger than l is less when l, so for every l is 1 or 0 for pl less than or equal to x, and if p power l is bigger than x, all of them are 0. So though this is an infinite, looks like an infinite sum, but it's a finite sum. Up to some L, everything will be zero. So therefore, And since we know that people are a device X to K, so a P power A has to be less than or equal to X. So suppose this order P dividing X to K is S, then order, then P power S should be less than or equal to X, which is less than P power S plus one. Therefore, P power A should be less than P power order of P to order of P to the binomial coefficient X to K, and which is less than P power S, which is less than X. So this is one basic information which we require for the proof. So by using that information, what I'm going to now prove is that if the largest prime factor of X is yes. So if the largest prime factor of X whose K is less than or equal to K, then X has to be bounded by K to the power K over K minus pi K. Remember that pi K counts the number of primes up to K. And not only that, what we can see is that if K is bigger than or equal to 11, then X has to be less than K square. And if K is bigger than or equal to 37, X is less than K power 3 by 2. So this is what we want to prove it now. Okay, so let's try to prove it. Now, X use K, you can write it as X by K, X minus 1 by K minus 1 up to X minus K plus 1 by 1. And each of the term X by K, X minus 1 by K minus 1 up, or X minus, everything, each of this factor, each of these numbers are all bigger than X by K. So, and there are terms. So that's, therefore X by X use K is bigger than X by K power K. This is a very trivial observation. Now again, since the largest prime factor of X whose K is less than K, and from the previous lemma, for every A such that P power A is less than X for P A dividing X whose K, and for every prime dividing X whose K, the power of that prime is actually at most X. And since they're all, and this is not divisible by any prime bigger than k, so X to K is actually less than or equal to X for pi k. Because for every prime, the largest prime divisor, P power A dividing X to K is always less than or equal to X. So, and there are pi k primes. So up to k, there are pi k primes. So X to K is less than or equal to X for pi k. Now you compare the upper and lower bounds for X to K. So that means xk by k power k is less than x power pi k, then that gives x power k minus pi k is less than k power k, and you divide by k, you divide the power by k minus pi k to get x is less than k to the power k by k minus pi k. So this is what we have. So from our assumption, if there is no prime divisor bigger than k, then X is less than this number. This is what I get. Now I want to measureize pi k. Of course, I don't want to use prime number theorem. So I will measureize by very elementary methods. What we know is that for a number k bigger than or equal to 11, so all the among the all the, I mean, so what if you exclude 1 and 9, they're at most k plus 1 by 2 minus 2 odd primes up to k. So basically number of odd numbers up to k is at most the integral part of k plus 1 by 2. And I'm excluding 1 and 9. So they're at most k plus 1 by 2 minus 2 odd primes. So total number of primes up to k is less than or equal to 1. 1 is coming from the prime 2 and odd primes, which is k plus 1 by 2 minus 2. And if you look at this, this number is less than or equal to k by 2. So for k bigger than or equal to 11, pi k is less than or equal to k by 2. And this gives, if you put pi k is less than or equal to k by 2 here, then x is less than k by k minus k by 2, or x is less than k square for k bigger than or equal to 11. This is what I get here. Now, again, we make further as a we want to replace pi k is less than k by 2 by another, like pi k is less than k by 3. Yeah, so we use certain ideas. So basically, what I know is that so you have to look, so you have to count the number of primes up to k. So we remove the numbers which are divided by 2, 3, or 5. Then remaining number, so number of primes will be less than or equal to the remaining numbers. So given any k, you remove the multiples of 2, 3, or 5. Then whatever number you are left is without 2, 3, and 5. Then if you count the number of primes up to k, so we will get an upper bound. So this is what we are using here. A number of integers up to k, positive integers up to k divisible by 2, 3, or 5 is actually integral part of k by 2 plus integral part of k by 3 plus integral part of k by 5 minus k integral part of k by 6 minus integral part of k by 10 minus integral part of k by 15. Actually, this is just a combinatorial argument. You take out numbers which are divisible by 2, divisible by 3, divisible by 5, then k by 6 gives the number of which are divisible by both 2, 3, and k by 10 gives the numbers which are divisible by both 2, 5, etc. And you have this number, and this is bigger than, you see, integral part of k by 2 is bigger than k by 2 minus 1, k by 3 minus 1, etc. So if you put all of this, then you get k by 2 plus k by 3 plus k by 5 k plus k by 30 minus k by 6 minus k by 10 minus k by 15 minus 7. Because 1, 2, 3, 4. From the 4 plus part, you get minus 4. And with this 3, you get 7. So there are at least 11 by 15 k minus 7 integers which are composite and divisible by 2, 3, or 5. Hence, number of primes up to k is less than or equal to k minus 1 minus this number, and which is less than or equal to k by 3 for k bigger than or equal to 90. So you can check easily that this number is less than k by 3 for k less bigger than or equal to 90. And by using the direct computation, so for k less than 90, you look when pi of k, number of primes up to k is less than or equal to k by 3, and we'll see that for numbers for k between 37 and 90, number of primes is less than or equal to k by 3. Hence, k over k minus pi k is less than 3 by 2 for all k bigger than or equal to 37. And this gives the our result. So that's what I've stated once again. So the largest prime factor of n to x choose k is less than k, then x is less than this number. And x is less than k squared for k bigger than or equal to 11. And x is less than k power 3 by 2 for k bigger than or equal to 37. This is what we get here. So now, you see, I have gone that, so to check, I need to check for x less than k squared. But so k can be anything. K can be million, billion, trillion, quadrillion, anything. So we need to get a bound which is completely finite and check it, right? So that's what we want to go. So to do that, we prove the following result. So suppose x is less than k power 3 by 2. So we know that for k bigger than 37, this is anyway true. So x is less than k power 3 by 2, then largest prime factor of x whose k is less than k implies the binomial coefficient x whose k should be less than 4 power k plus root x. So this is the main idea. Main elementary idea, which is actually crucial for our proof. So I'll try to explain the proof. This is quite, I mean, this look, this is a very interesting idea. So what I want to tell you is that this elementary arguments, though it looks very simple, but when we look at more advanced generalizations, etc., actually we have to generalize all these ideas. So these are basic, these are foundations, and we're going to generalize this to prove more advanced results. Okay, so let's try to prove it. So our aim is to prove that x whose k is less than 4 power k plus root x. So first, let's make some assumption. For any given k, suppose if you take product of primes up to k and product of primes up to root k into product of primes up to cube root of k, etc., suppose assume that all this product is less than 4 power k. We'll prove it later on. So I made this assumption. Now I put instead of k, you put root x. Then this product p less than root x, p less than x power 1 over 4, p less than x power 1 over 6, everything is less than 4 root x. And from the fact that x is less than k power 3 by 2, one can see easily that for every l bigger than or equal to 2, the 2l minus 1 root of x is less than l at root of k. So this is easy. Now, once I noted, I try to measure x to k. Now, x to k okay, so x to k is nothing but the primes which divides the power of primes dividing x to k, where p power a is the exact power of p dividing x to k. Now, you divide these powers into primes less than k. We know that prime divisors are less than k. Then you take primes less than root x, primes less than cube root of x, etc. So this is what you're going to do. Now you divide this product into two products, all primes less than k, primes less than root k, etc. And primes less than root x, and primes less than, and from the fact that the odd, so odd is odd roots of x is less than l roots of k. So when p is, for example, p is less than cube root of x, yeah, so then p is less than square root of k. So then you put, I mean, the for the odd roots, you put them inside this part, and even roots, you put inside this part. And from our result, from 9 and this fact that 9 with k and root x, basically the whole products become 4 to the power k plus root x. So this is what we wanted to prove. Once we know that 9 is true, then x to k is less than 4 to the power k plus root x. So our aim is to prove the as our assumption 9, that is for every k, product of primes up to k into product of primes up to root k up to root 3k extra, everything is less than 4 power k. Now let's try to prove it. So here I'm using another fact. For every prime p and positive integer a such that so p power a lies between k and 2k, then the largest power of p, which the exact power of p dividing 2k to k is actually same as the power of p dividing 2k factorial by k factorial whole square. And this one you can write it as 2k to the integral part of 2k over pi minus 2 times k over pi. This follows from that order of p dividing k factorial is k integral part of k by p plus k by p square, etc. And by using the fact that 2k over integral part of 2k over pi minus 2 over, so 2 times k over pi is at least is always non-negative. And exactly when I is equal to a, so because p power a lies between k and 2k, this number is actually 1. When I equal to a. So that's why this when we have p power a is, lies between k and 2k, p divides 2k to k. This is what we have. So we're going to use it. Now so corresponding to the greatest integer function, let's define the least integer function. So least integer function is denoted by this bracket nu, which is the integer which is bigger than or equal to nu. So you take power of, so you take m such that k lies between 2 power m minus 1 and 2m. Then you put a1 to be the least integer function of k by 2, a2 to be least integer function of k by 2 square, and so on. And since 2 power m minus 1 is less than k is less than 2m, am is actually 1. After m, everything is 0. So anyway, we're going to just see till m. And not only that, this sequence a1 is bigger than a2 is bigger than am, And for any ith, a ith is actually k over 2 ith, which is less than k over 2 ith plus 1, which you can write it as 2k by 2 power ith plus 1 plus 1. And this one, you can see that this is less than 2 times a ith plus 1 plus 1. So basically, what I'm showing is that a ith, the number a, for any ith, a ith is less than 2 times a ith plus 1 plus 1. And a integer which is less than or equal to another integer, because of this, we get actually a ith is less than 2 times a ith plus 1. So this is what we're getting. Also, if you look at 2a2, what is 2a2? 2a2 is k by 2 4. A2 is k by 4. So 2a2 is less than k by 2 plus 2. And k by 2 is, and this is less than or equal to a1 plus 2. And so since 2a2 is less than or equal to a1 plus 2, that's 2a2 is strictly less than a1 plus 2. That's why 2a2 is less than or equal to a1 plus 1. So basically, if I have, so what I'm using is that since if a number n is less than k, then n is less than or equal to k minus 1. This is what we are using. Anyway, so these are some basic facts. So because of this fact that this am is 1 and ai is in increasing order, what we actually obtain is that every integers between 1 and k, they lie between this intervals. So for every ith from 1 to m, you take interval ith and 2 ith. So all the numbers from 1 to k lie in this union of these intervals. So now you take p and r to be integers, like p is a prime, r be integers, such that k lies between p power r and p power r plus 1. And take a number between 1 and r. Then since I is less than or equal to r, p power I is less than or equal to k. And because of that, there exists its I such that a of its I is less than pi, which is less than 2 times a its I. So once p of I lies between a its I and 2 its I, because of our earlier result, p divides 2a. 2 ahi by so the binomial coefficient 2 ahi over ahi. So here I want to just remind you the following. So for any a, if k lies between p power a lies between k and 2k, then p divides 2k choose k. This is what I'm using here. So for any I, I'm getting p power I lies between ahi and 2 ahi. So that's why p divides this binomial coefficient. And also we observe that for I and j different, which lies for I and j between 1 and r, and which are I and j not equal, ASI is not equal to ASJ. Because it follows from fact that P times ASA is less than PJ plus 1, which is less than PI is less than 2 ASI. So if I equal to j, we'll get a contradiction here. So if for any number I between 1 and r, you have a number ahi which are all distinct. So p into, so if I take number between 1 to r, p power r, which is p into p r times. So p divides 2a1, the binomial coefficient 2a1 over a1, and p divides 2a2 over a2 and so on. So this number p power r divides this number, this product. And what is our p power r? P power r is a number which lies between k lies between p power r and p power r plus 1. Therefore, the product of primes less than k, or product of primes less than k half extra. So the whole product is nothing but p power r, where p power r lies between k and k lies between p power r and p power r plus 1. And which is less than 2a1 choose a1, 2a2 choose a2, and so on. So to show that this left-hand side is less than 4 power k, it suffices to show that the right-hand side here is less than 4 power k. for direct calculation, like if you take k less than or equal to 10, this is true. For example, when k is 5, a1 was this integer function of k 5 over 2, which is 3, then 5 over 4 is 2, and 5 over 6 is 1. And if you take this product, it's nothing but 20 into 6 into 2, which is less than 4 power 5. So four numbers between like 4, 2, 3, and 5, you can see easily, 2, 3, 5, 7, you can see easily that this is true. Now, so that's why we're going to take k bigger than or equal to 11. So here we use the induction. So suppose, so we are having k bigger than 10, and suppose that assumption is true. So that means, suppose this is true for some k bigger than or equal to bigger than 10. And so we assume, okay, we're going to use the induction. So suppose it's true for every integer less than k, and we have to prove at k. So since this is less true for less than k, so 2a1 choose a1, 2a2, because a1 is less than k, 2a1 is less than k, so 2a1 choose a1, 2a2 choose, all of these numbers are less than 2a1, choose a1 times 4 power 2a2 minus 1. So here I'm using the fact that if you, so you take, you replace k by 2a2 minus 1, then this whole part is actually less than 4 times 4 to the power 2a2 minus 1. So this whole product becomes this. Now I want to also use another fact that 4k bigger than 8, 2k choose k is less than 4 power k minus 1. I'm going to prove it later on. So if you assume this 2k choose k is less than 4 power k minus 1, then the right hand side of display 12 is actually less than 4 power a1 minus 1 plus 2a2 minus 1. And since 2a1 is less than k plus 1 and 2a2 is less than a1 plus 1, by combining this, this product, this number actually becomes 4 power k, and our proof is complete. So it just boils down to proving the fact that 2k choose k is less than 4 power k minus 1. So these are very simple ideas, but very basic and important ideas. So now let's try to prove that result. In fact, I need this fact. So if I prove this, then when k is 8, this is nothing but 4 power k by 16, root 16. So this is 4 power k minus 1. So 4k bigger than or equal to 8, 2k choose k will be less than 4 power k minus 1. But we'll prove more general. So this is a very simple and very nice proof, actually. So the largest prime factor, so the upper bound for 2k choose k is actually less than 4 power k divided by root 2k. So let's see how the proof works. As you can see, it's just one line proof. So if you take this 1 minus 1 over 2 square, 1 minus 2, 4 square extra up to 1 minus 1 over 2k minus 2 square, everything is less than 1, so the whole product is less than 1. So 1 is bigger than this whole product. And you write 1 minus 1 over 2 square is 1 into 3 by 2 square. And this is 3 into 5 by 4 square and so on. And this one is 2k minus 3 times 2k minus 1 by 2k minus 2 square. Now you multiply both numerator and denominator by 2k minus 1 so that this number become 1 over 2k minus 1 times a numerator becomes 3, 5 into 2k minus 1 whole square. And denominator is 2 square, 4 square, etc. You can write it as 2 power k, k factorial into 2k whole square. So you can put this. This is very easy to see. And if you see the part inside here, so now 2k square, 2k you take out. So 4k square by 2k. And this is the remaining part is nothing but 2k factorial by 4k. Into k factorial square. Now 4k square by 2k is nothing but 2k. So the last part is 2k over 4 power k into 2k choose k. So by taking the square root, you get the inequality of 13, which we wanted. So the proof here is very simple. Now I prove the lower bound. So remember then for the upper bound is 4 power k by root 2k. And for the lower bound is 4k divided by 2 root k. So for the lower bound, I use the odd numbers here instead of even numbers. So one is bigger than 1 - 3² into 1 - 5² and up to 1 - 2k - 1² And you write it as 2 × 4/3², 4 × 6/5² and so on. And you take out, divide by, take out 1/4k and write everything as 2k into k factorial by 3/5 up to 2k - 1 factorial. And which you can actually write it as 1/4k into 4k into k factorial square by 2k factorial whole square. Now, you take square root of both sides and you get the inequality that we wanted. So this is a very elementary proof, but very nice and clean proof. Well, so what I've done, I want to just refresh them. So what I've done so far is that if the largest prime factor of x choose k is less than k, then x is less than k power k by pi min, k minus pi k. And 4k bigger than 11, x is less than k square. And 4k bigger than 32, x is less than k power 3/2. This is what we have proved. And what I prove is that when x is less than k power 3/2, then x choose k is less than 4 power k plus root x. And of course, since x is less than k power 3/2, which is definitely less than k plus k power 3/4. And as 4k bigger than 1, 2k choose k has this upper and lower bounds. So lower bound is 4k over 2 root k, and upper bound is 4k by root 2k. So this is what I have done so far. So I'm going to use these facts. So now let's take x less than k power 3/2. For x bigger than, 4x bigger than 4, bigger than or equal to 4k, then we can see easily that x choose k is bigger than or equal to 4k choose k, and which is actually less than 4 power k plus root x, which is 4 power k plus, 4 to the power k plus k 3/4. So now you look at upper and lower bounds. So 4 power k plus k 3/4 is bigger than 4k choose k. And you write 4k choose k is 2k choose k times the product 4k into 4k minus 1 up to 3k plus 1 by this denominator. What I've written here, 2k into 2k minus 1, etc. And I'm using that 2k choose k is bigger than 4 power k by 2 root k, bigger than this. And remaining part is of the term is bigger than 2. One can check easily. So it's bigger than 2 power k. So the left hand side is bigger than a power k by 2 root k. So this is just, there's no other term. We're just having k. So you can now check these inequalities. Similarly, for x between 5/2k and 4k, then x choose k is nothing but this integer part of 5/2k choose k. And on the right hand side, you have this k plus root 2k because x is less than 4k. So what we have is the following: 4 power k plus root 2k, 2 root k is nothing but 2k choose k, the remaining number. And 2k choose k is bigger than 4k by 2 root k. And remaining part is less than is bigger than 5/4 power k. So here now everything is in terms of k. There's no x involved here. And again, when x, we know that x is at least 2k. So I've taken x bigger than 4k. I've taken x between 5/2 and 4k. Now when x lies between 2k and 5/2k, then 2k choose x choose k is bigger than or equal to 2k choose k. And since x is less than 5/2k, so this number is less than or equal to k power 4 to the power k plus root 5/2k. So inequality, 4 power k plus root 5k by 2 is bigger than this number. So once we compare this inequality, so this inequality is not true. This is not true for any k that we can see. In fact, one way to check is that the right hand side, yeah, so you can take log on both sides and look at the little bit of calculus, or otherwise also you can just take that the right hand side here always exists left hand side. And in this part is, I mean, for some after some time is false, and this also after some time is false. So what we get is that comparing the bounds, 4k bigger than or equal to 11, we always get x is less than 4k. So x bigger than or equal to 4k doesn't work. And when x lies between 5 by 2k and 4k, k is actually less than 1/103. And when x lies between 2k and 5 by 2k, k lies between k is less than 113. Now I want you to recall the fact that x is less than k over k to the power k over k minus pi k, and x is less than k square for k bigger than or equal to 11, and x is less than k power 3 by 2 for k bigger than 37. So combining all of this, what we just need to, we just need to take k less than or equal to 113 from all this information. Well, if 4k bigger than 113, there's nothing left. And case, and when k lies between 11 and 31, x is less than k square. And when k lies between 37 and 113, x is less than 4k. And not only that, 4k less than 11, x is less than k power k minus k to the power this number. So I have now only finally many choices of x and k to be checked. So from the infinite thing, I've just now come down to finally many cases. Now here I want to use another interesting idea of Sylvester and Erdős. So idea is very simple and it's worth knowing it. So that's why I'm explaining here. So let's take S to be set of k numbers, x, x minus 1 up to x minus k plus 1. So for every prime less than k, so we know that, you see, this is a product of k numbers, this is a k consecutive integers, is divisible by k factorial. That means every prime less than k divides this number. So for every prime p less than k, you choose number ip, which lies between 0 and k, such that p divides x minus ip to the highest power. So if you look at the power of prime dividing, power p dividing x, x minus 1, x prime, ip is the one where it's dividing to the highest power. Then whenever I is not equal to ip, what we have is that power of p dividing x minus I is less than power of p dividing x minus I minus x minus ip, which is less than, so that means the left hand side is less than or equal to power of p dividing I minus ip. So once we have this, you take S not S from this set X, set S, you remove this X minus IP, where for every prime less than K, you take out X minus IP. Then you're left with at least K minus pi K numbers in this set. And not only that, for you see, I is running, so you have just removed IP. So for every number between 0 to k, prime p divides this to the order ip factorial into k minus 1 minus ip factorial. And since the binomial coefficient k minus 1 choose ip is integer, so this order of p dividing ip factorial into k minus 1 minus ip factorial is, in fact, less than or equal to order of p dividing k minus 1 factorial. So this is very nice idea of Sylvester and Erdős. Actually, this is used repeatedly in the more advanced proofs on the generalizations in many other areas. So it's a very simple but very basic idea, which is very useful. So once I have this, so the product of all x minus I, which is in the x node, is less than prime less than or equal to k p minus factorial. And this number is nothing but less than or equal to k minus 1 factorial. So once you take out the terms which are divisible by prime to the highest power, remaining part is divisible by k minus 1 factorial. So by using the fact that this number of elements in S node is at least k minus pi k, and the least number in the set x minus 1 up to x minus k minus 1 is x minus k plus 1, you get x minus k plus 1 power k minus pi k is less than or equal to k minus 1 factorial. Or if you take, or other way to write is that x is less than k minus 1 plus k minus 1 factorial to the power 1 over k minus pi k. This is what we have. And of course, since pi, you see, when k is 2, k minus pi k is actually 1. So the equality works only when k is 2, for k then equality doesn't work. So for k 2, 3, 5, 7, we can see that x is less than 2, x is less than 4, x is, when x, k is 2, x is less than or equal to 2, when k is 3, x is less than 4, and k is 5, x is less than 9, and k is 7, x is less than 13. So this is a contradiction because we have taken x to be bigger than or equal to 2k. That's why we can now take that k is bigger than or equal to 11. Now for any k between 11 and 31, you just check the bounds and you can see that x is actually less than or equal to 71. So k is a fix, so k is a prime, and for every prime between 11 and 31, you check, you see these numbers. See them, and maximum of them is less than or equal to 71. So finally, what we need to do is that we need to check for numbers between 11 and 113. And for k between 11 and 31, x is less than 71. And for k between 37 and 113, x is less than 4k. Okay, so how do you check this? Of course, you can do it by brute force, but we can. In mathematics, it's all about making things simpler or more, what you say, smart, in a smarter way. So instead of doing brute force, we just make another way. So this is the following lemma, which is quite easy. So what I want to say is that take any positive real number and any positive integer k naught. Suppose the difference between consecutive primes is less than k naught for all primes less than p of pi x plus 1. Remember that p of pi x plus 1 is the least prime bigger than x. So if this assumption is true, then the largest prime factor of x minus 1 up to x minus k plus 1 is bigger than k for x lying between 2k and x, and for all k bigger than or equal to k now. So this is the lemma which we actually need to do it. So a proof is also very simple. Let me just try to give a proof. Suppose x lies between 2k and x, then if one of this number x minus up to x minus 1, x minus k plus 1 is a prime, we are done, because then the largest prime factor will be that prime, and that prime is bigger than k. So we assume that none of this is a prime. So that means, since none of this is a prime, there's a prime which lies, so there's a prime which is, so this, all these numbers lies between two, x minus pi k plus one is bigger than p of pi x minus k plus one, and this remaining part is less than or equal to p of pi x plus one. So by our assumption, so the difference between these two part, x minus k plus 1 is k minus 1, which is less than the difference between this left-hand side and right side, that is p of pi x plus 1. No, actually, there's a mistake here. Okay, this x should be replaced by x minus k plus 1. So x minus k plus 1 plus 1. And by our assumption, this is less than k. So that means k minus 1 is strictly less than k, means k is strictly less than k naught, which is a contradiction. So what I have proved is the, so what I have proved is the following. So if the difference between consecutive primes is less than k naught, then largest prime factor of, should be bigger than k for all k bigger than or equal to k naught. Now I make some computations. So for primes up to 457, the difference between consecutive primes is less than 21, and for primes up to 79, the difference between consecutive primes is less than 8. Now we apply that lemma here. For k between 23 and 31, you take x is 452, k naught is 21. So that means largest prime factor, difference between consecutive prime is less than 21, but 23 is bigger than 21, and we're done. So we have a prime factor bigger than or equal to 23. And for k between 11 and 31, you take x is 33 and k naught is 10. Then because of our lemma, it follows that for any k consecutive integers, largest prime factor should be bigger than k. And this proof, this completes the proof. Well, so what I've done here is I've given a completely elementary proof, completely basic proof without using higher, any bit of higher mathematics. Or I mean higher means any advanced mathematics like prime number theory or linear forms, extra. So this is the result. Now I want to just, okay, in the remaining part, my proof, now there'll be no more proof. I want to just talk about generalization. So what I would say is that this, all these ideas are generalized with more sophisticated mathematics to prove more generalizations. So yeah, I want to talk a little bit more about the generalizations. So Sylvester result tells you that largest prime factor of n plus 1 to n plus k is bigger than k. And this was improved by Moser for, you replace k by 11 over 10k. And I mean, so our aim is how far we can improve. Then Hansen improved it to 1.5k, except when k is, I mean, some numbers. And also there are some other numbers, some other results. So for k equal to 2, let's see what is the best possible. When k equal to 2, product of n plus 1 and plus 2 will have a prime factor bigger than 4, except when n is equal to 1 to 7. So this actually, so this follows from the fact that if this less than or equal to, the largest prime factor is less than or equal to 3, one of them is 4 or 2. Yes, I'm not able to hear.
Sorry, sir, please go ahead.
Maybe I'll take 5 more minutes because I think, you must, it's okay, right?
Sir, you can take 8 more minutes.
Okay, yeah, sure. Yes. So for k equal to 2, I mean, so you want to say that largest prime factor is bigger than 4. If it's not true, that means largest prime factor is 3, means one of them is 4 of 2, one of them is a 4 of 3. And that's only possible when n is 1, 2, 7. Here, even the Catalan conjecture extra coming in, but I won't go into it. So this is the best result which we have now. So in fact, for n bigger than or equal to k, so this is a result of myself with my PhD advisor, Tien Sore. But we proved that largest prime factor is bigger than 1.95k for k, n bigger than k, for n k belongs to an explicit set. I'm not going to write down the set. And what I'll say is that you cannot replace this number 1.95 by 2, because when n is equal to k, you have k plus 1 to 2k. So largest prime factor is anyway less than 2k. You cannot replace by anything less than k. And of course, we if you want to have a result which is a bit nice looking, then I can make it bigger than 1.8k. This has actually applications in other areas of mathematics too. So largest prime factor is bigger than 1.8k unless n is k belongs, and n equal to k belongs to this set, or nk is in some other set. Also, if you take, instead of n bigger than or equal to k, if you take n bigger than a larger number, say like, for example, if n is bigger than maximum k plus 13 and 279 by 262k, then you can have a prime factor bigger than 2k. And here, of course, I cannot just take a k plus some constant. Actually, I have to take some other k plus a factor, another factor of k. So this, these are some ideas. Now that these are for consecutive integers, now I want to talk a bit more about arithmetic progressions. So let n and d, I've been talking about the consecutive integers. We can do the similar thing for arithmetic progression, but their life is much more complicated. So I'm not going to give any other proof here, no more proofs, but I'm going to tell you some results and some idea of what's happening here. For given n, d, and k, you write with n and d coprime, and d bigger than one, you put delta of n, d, k to be the product n plus d up to n plus 2d up to n plus k minus 1d. It's nothing but product of first k terms of arithmetic progression starting at n and common difference d. Now when k is 2, you have n into n plus d. And we observe that if you take n equal to 1, d equal to 2 power r minus d, or n equal to say 3, d equal to 2 power r minus 3, etc., you can have that the infinitely many n and d such that there are infinitely many n and d such that largest prime factor is actually 2. So in this regard, it's the result of Sylvester. Sylvester himself, he proved that if n is bigger than or equal to d plus k, then largest prime factor of this n plus d up to n plus k minus 1 d is bigger than k. Now let's take d equal to 2. What happens when d equal to 2? D equal to 2 means it's the all odd numbers from n to n plus 2k minus 1. So when n is less than or equal to k, then largest prime factor is less than 2k. So this implies largest prime factor of n plus k up to n plus 2k minus 1 is actually less than 2k. Now here we can use our earlier result for d equal to 1. So now it becomes n plus k plus 1 extra. This is product of k consecutive integers starting at n plus k. This shows that n plus k minus 1 is less than maximum of k plus 13 over 279 by 262 k, or n is less than maximum this. So basically when d equal to 2, we always have a prime divisor bigger than 2k unless n is less than maximum of 14 and 17 by 262 k plus 1. So it's well understood. So we'll take k bigger than 2 and d bigger than 2. So k equal to 2 also is well understood, and d bigger than 2 also well understood. So regarding this, it's a result of Langevin, who proved that largest prime factor is bigger than k if n is bigger than k. So Sylvester proved that n is bigger than or equal to d plus k. So he removed the dependence on d. So for any n bigger than k, largest prime factor is bigger than k is true. And Soren Tiedemann proved that largest prime factor of consecutive terms of arithmetic progression is bigger than k without any assumption on n bigger than k or not, except when n dk is 273. So n is 2, d is 7, k is 3. So in this case, it's 2 into 2 plus 7 is 9, and 2 plus 14 is 16. Except for every other n, d, and k, the largest prime factor is always bigger than k. And this was actually refined, generalized further by myself with Sore. But we saw that for k bigger than 2 and d bigger than 2, largest prime factor is actually always bigger than, instead of k, we can have 2k, except for some exceptions, like for example, k equal to 3, n equal to 1, d equal to 4, 7, etc. So this is what, so basically right now we know that we have generalized Sylvester's result by proving that there is a largest prime factor. So there's a prime bigger than 2k dividing product of any consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression. And so far this is the best known result. In fact, we can, like, if we make more assumptions, like if n is bigger than 3k, then product of k consecutive integers with common different three will, you can show that it's bigger than 3k and 4k, etc. So here I would like to state the conjecture, which is an open problem. If you fix d, then for n bigger than dk and k bigger than 1, the largest prime factor of n, n plus t up to n plus k minus 1, d is always bigger than dk, except for finitely many n and k. So this is an open problem, and this has very nice and interesting concept. It's a very difficult problem because we don't know how to actually prove it for large values of d. For example, d is equal to like 3, 4, 2, 3, 4, we have proved it is easy. But for d large, is difficult to prove. And I want to tell you something here. So it's in case of Sylvester theorem, we have a proof which is completely elementary without going to any ideas of prime number theory, etc. But for the generalizations, for the advanced results, we need more advanced ideas from prime number theory, linear forms in logarithms, Douay equations, even Fermat equations like Fermat's last theorem, etc. I mean, so equations coming from the special cases of Fermat's last theorem, etc. However, all the ideas, basic ideas, what I've explained in the proof I've given, these are very basic. Actually, everything is built on this. So these are the sort of our foundation. So over that we build and we generalize those ideas and prove it. So this is what we have done it. And so not only that, here we can talk about the number of prime divisors, where and it's intimately connected to many of these well-known areas in other problems in mathematics, like Mersenne prime conjecture. That is, there are infinitely many primes of the form 2p-1 of Fermat prime, or even Catalan conjecture. So since I don't, I'm not going to go deep into it. So I'm going to share this slide later on. You can see and read this, but I just want to tell you that though the problem looks very simple, but it's intimately connected to many other important problems in number theory. And in fact, I just want to just go a bit fast. So I want to state the following conjecture of Grimm, which is another very difficult open problem. Suppose if you have this n plus 1 up to n plus k, if you take if you take k consecutive integers, which are all composite, then the Grimm's conjecture tells you that there you can find k distinct primes, p1, p2, pk, such that p1 divides n plus 1, p2 divides n plus 2, p3 divides n plus k. So this problem, which looks really very simple, is actually quite difficult. And right now, of course, we don't know how to prove it. And Grimm's conjecture, it also implies that the gap between consecutive primes is quite low. I mean, so which is better than the Riemann hypothesis tells you that suppose P and Q are the consecutive primes, then Q minus P is less than P power half times log P. But Grimm's conjecture tells you that Q minus P is less than P power 0.46, which is better than what is given by Riemann hypothesis, which is another difficult problem. And this also proves the Legendre conjecture. For between any two consecutive squares, there's always a prime. So this is very difficult conjecture. So far, this has been verified for all n bigger than 1.9 into 10 power 10 and for all k. This is done by me and Sore in one of our papers. And this is also connected to Singel hypothesis, which tells you that if you have a number of irreducible non-constant polynomials with integer coefficients and leading coefficient positive, suppose that for every prime p, you find an integer such that f1a, f2a, fra, these are none of this is divisible by p. Then you can find infinitely many m such that f1m, f2m, up to frm, these are all primes. And this is also another open problem which is considered quite difficult. And finally, I just want to tell you something about some applications. So all these results and results about largest prime factor or greatest prime factor, these are, this has applications in binary recurrence sequence on this Fibonacci, you want to prove some important results about Fibonacci sequence or any other binary recurrence sequence, or about exponential Diophantine equations, or even there's an open problem of conjecture of errors, which states that if you take product of any k consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression, is never a perfect square. This is open, though there's some results are not, but this is quite open. So even on this, there we have some applications. And also it has applications so that so that some polynomials are irreducible, or even in the, so that a family of polynomials is irreducible. For example, if you take the truncated exponential polynomials, which is, you take, you see, you know that e power x is 1 plus x squared by 2 factorial plus x cubed by 3 factorial, etc. You truncate at n. So that means enx is 1 plus x squared by 2 factorial plus x cubed by 3 factorial, etc. to xn by n factorial. Then by using our results of Sylvester's result, we can show that all these polynomials are irreducible for every n bigger than 1 plus 1. So these are some of these applications, and not only this, there are many other applications, but I'm not going to go in, but what I want to just emphasize here is that the very basic ideas, very basic looking problems, it has a lot of interesting applications, and in fact, also it opens up a lot of new problems, which we still don't know how to prove. So that's all for now, thank you.
Thank you, sir. If I may ask the participants if they can unmute themselves and give a round of applause for the very nice talk. So if you can please unmute yourself and give a clap. Thank you. Sir, there are several questions in the chat. Facebook.
Then I'll stop sharing it.
You can stop sharing, sir. Thank you for the nice talk. Manjil, you please begin the question answer session.
Yes. So if you have questions, you can write it in the chat. I have already got some questions, which I'll ask now.
Yeah, I have got some from YouTube also.
Okay. The first question is from Tomabo Chakraborty, who is asking, you know that smallest gap between two primes is 2. What is the largest gap till now?
Actually, this is what I have told you. So the conjecturally, see, the largest gap, so if P and Q are consecutive primes, so the largest gap Q minus P is always less than, right now the non-prime is that, non-bound is less than P to the power 0.565. So that means so Q minus P is less than P power half plus epsilon. So that's the with epsilon is around 0.1 or some 0.1 or something. This is 0.6. So this is what we know now for substantially large. And Riemann hypothesis, which is a $1 million problem, tells you that this is less than half plus epsilon. And Grimm's conjecture, I told you, it tells you that it's less than 0.46.
Okay, thank you, sir.
I hope it answers. So basically, I mean, largest gap can go to infinity. So but the thing is that depending on the conjecture U and P, then it's less than P power 0.46. That is that follows from Grimm's conjecture.
Okay, sir. Sir, Madhumita Mohanty is asking, may I know who gave the elementary proof of Sylvester Erdős theorem?
Actually, the thing is that...
Hello?
Yeah?
Yeah, Shanta sir.
Hello, yes?
Can you please stop the sharing option and make yourself visible?
Okay.
It will be better, I think.
Okay, yes. Okay. So
stop sharing.
All right, yeah, yeah, yes. Okay. So about this proof of elementary proof, so basically, there's been Sylvester actually, so the proof was first given by Sylvester, but no, that was not the proof which is I presented here. Erdős gave another proof which is not this proof, but by combining those ideas and we actually gave a complete proof. So by different, actually, yeah. So by combining different ideas from earlier proofs, so this was actually stated in my MSc thesis, the proof. So, but then I won't say that this is my proof because all the ideas have been there before. But we, I mean, I just gave another simplification.
Okay, sir. Sir, Harish Yadav is asking how to use this theory for irreducibility of polynomial. Any example?
Yeah, so that's what I've given you in that truncated polynomial. So there's this notion of something called Newton polygon. So given any polynomial with integer coefficient, you can make this Newton polygon. So Newton polygons, it tells you about, so depending on coefficients, it's a, you can draw a Newton polygon. It's a polygonal part formed by this power of primes, which divides these coefficients. And with the information from that, we can show that, okay, this polynomial is irreducible or it doesn't have a factor of certain degree. And there, in the particular example where I've given this truncated exponential polynomial or Suhr polynomial or Bessel or any Hermit, so there, once you have this product of consecutive integers or consecutive terms of arithmetic progression, we can use largest prime factors or number of prime factors. So it's another actual work. So I need to explain a bit more on this.
Sir, there are two general questions which have come on Facebook. I'll just ask you, and if you could give some idea. Lagan Gupta is asking, if someone has never studied number theory, from where should he or she start? Which books should be followed? And if there is some computer applications which are helpful or necessary to be learned for the same, what are they?
Well, for the number theory, well, there are a lot of books. So for the first starting point, I will probably say, okay, Hardy and Wright is a nice book, but probably it's not the best thing to start. So Burton is too basic. Okay, so maybe I'll suggest that they study a little bit of Burton, and then later on go to Hardy and Wright or Niven and Zuckerman. So they will give you some basics of number theory. And after that, so is it, right now for the basic number theory, you don't need much computer applications, but it's good to learn. I mean, so when you want to search, like for example, sequence of primes, you want to show some properties, so take certain properties, good to know some computer programming. Nowadays you can use CES, CESMAP, that's quite useful. So if you know how to use it, it's quite helpful.
Thank you, sir. There is one more question, which is the last question from Facebook by Amir Hamid. He's asking, which part of number theory has more applications in day-to-day life?
Well, that's a very difficult thing to say, but I mean, right now, you see the prime numbers, they're very useful. Earlier, of course, it was, we considered them useless, but right now they're very useful because all this internet security, I mean, or cryptography, that depends on the information of prime numbers. And all this, your RSA crypto system, they work on this difficulty of factorization method. In fact, when you use your credit card or ATM machines, you're actually using prime numbers in a different way. So that's what, I mean, quite useful, but of course you don't see the primes, but I mean, they're in fact used in between. But I cannot say that this something is much more use or not. But of course, prime numbers, elliptic curves, these are quite used a lot these days for cryptographic purposes.
Sir, then Devasis has some question from YouTube. He will ask now.
Yeah, hello, sir. So there is one question from Dr. Rangaraj Bhattacharji, who is from State Cancer Institute, Guwahati Medical College. So not basically linked with mathematics. So he has a question, what is the physical significance of arithmetic progression? Any comments on that, sir?
Okay, well, what's the question? Can you please tell me? Maybe I know.
About physical significance of arithmetic progression.
Physical significance. Of course, you see, okay, all these prime numbers, arithmetic progression, they're coming in different forms in different ways. Even in medical sciences, also, like numbers, you have a sequence when you like to look at some patterns, or I mean, even Fibonacci numbers or even prime numbers have different ways. But I can't really say physical significance. But when you look at when I mean some patterns always come up, either it can be pattern of primes or arithmetic progression. So this always comes up in that sense. I can't give you a concrete example.
That's good. Sir, one more thing, this one, are there infinitely many primes in every arithmetic progression? Can we say that there are infinitely many primes? Are there infinitely many primes in every arithmetic
progression? Yes, actually, there are infinitely many primes in arithmetic progression. And that is always given by actually the proof of Sylvester. So not a proof. So largest prime factor of a product of k consecutive primes of arithmetic progression is bigger than k. So that also tells you that for every k, there's a prime bigger than k. So there are infinitely many primes in arithmetic progression.
In any given arithmetic progression.
Any given arithmetic progression.
So is there any some kind of common distribution of the primes? Or means some pattern they show in an arithmetic progression?
Yeah, well, that's what people have been trying to understand. So in an arithmetic progression, for example, you take an arithmetic progression of, any length, but common difference, say, 100. So then, you see, primes are going to be congruent to 1 mod 100 or 3 mod 100 or 7 mod 100 or etc. So for every number which is congruent, which is coprime to 100, so then you count the number of primes which are congruent to that. So like A is congruent to for every A coprime to 100, say primes which are congruent to A mod 100, you count the number of such primes. And for another B, you count number of primes which is congruent to B mod 100. And look at all these residue classes. There are 500, which is 500 is on 40, right? The 40 residue classes.
500.
So of these 40 residue classes, so you divide the primes into these 40 residue classes and ask whether some residue classes have more primes or some residue classes more less primes. So this is another area of research which is followed by different people. So something called prime number racing.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Okay.
There are two more questions that I have got now. One is by Abhishek Sharma. He's asking, what is the scope of future research in this field?
Well, actually, scope is, there are a lot of scope. You see, we have a lot of open problems to I've just given you some basic problems, but a lot of open problems in areas where prime numbers or arithmetic progressions are used. And we don't have a scarcity of problem, but we have a scarcity of solution. So, of course, now that enough technology, problems are getting more and more difficult, but if you have new ideas, of course, then you can always get new results, new theorems. So there are a lot of scope actually. So scope is less, but only that we need more ideas.
One more question from Biswanath Samanta. Yeah. He's asking, any other application of this theory except for showing irreducibility of polynomials?
So that's what actually I've given. It has applications in binary recurrent sequences. Like when you talk about some properties involving Fibonacci sequence, even there are actually this prime number or the distribution of primes in arithmetic progression is coming. For example, you want to say, suppose, can Fibonacci sequence be product of be a factorial or binomial coefficient? Such things, these primes are coming into picture. And not only that, like when you look at this Catalan conjecture or like exponential Diophantine equations, exponential Diophantine equations, in many of these places, these things are coming into picture. So it's actually coming at many places. So I didn't have much time. So I just showed you the example of truncated exponential polynomial. And so there's this conjecture. So one can show that a product of any k consecutive integers is never a perfect power. There are these things are being applied.
So one more question, sir, from Devanshu Ghosh. I guess I know the answer, but I'm still asking. So are there infinitely many primes in Fibonacci numbers? So I guess this is probably not known yet.
That's an open problem.
Yes. Many of the people are asking, sir, if you can give the presentation of the file. Is it possible to share the presentation?
I don't know. Maybe one option is that I can send you the file. You can put it in Ganesh Chora website. You can download. Other way.
You can send it to me. I'll upload that in Ganesh Chora.
I'll send it to you.
Yeah, there is one more question in YouTube from Purna Shetty. She is asking, can you give an idea of the algorithm that will provide the least complexity in terms of large prime factorization?
Complexity of?
Can I repeat?
Yeah, can you please repeat that?
Can you give an idea of the algorithm that provides the least complexity in terms of large prime factorization?
I mean, a large prime factor means you're given a large number and you have to factor it and you have to
get the... So the algorithm will provide the least complexity.
Right now, the best known and best and most useful factorization is number field shape, but it still is in the exponential, complexity. So far, we don't have any quasi-polynomial or anything. So, so these are all exponential complexity. And so you have to see this number field shape. So if you understand, if you see numbers field shape, and if you see how the complexity is calculated, you'll understand more. So for that, I need to actually go to a bit more, I need to give you more background, etc. But it's not that easy to just say that, okay, this complexity is that less. But you can try to see, our brute force factorization is, of course, exponential, but complexity is very high. And there's elliptic curve factoring method, but then to do that, I need to explain what is elliptic curve, how it's being applied, or even number fields. If then I go to number fields and this thing. So there, the complexity is being calculated on that. So you can try to actually just see one of these, articles on number fields. They'll give you that.
Okay, sir. So Manjil, it's over to you. Any other queries?
No, there is one which is related to cosmology, but we can skip that.
Meanwhile, I'd like to make an announcement that our student Rahul will share the link of the feedback form. So participants can fill up the feedback form. Only registered participants can fill it up. And the certificate will be mailed. It will be provided in the comment section. It will not be mailed to everybody. The feedback form will not be mailed. It will be provided in the chat box as well as the comment section in YouTube and Facebook. I'd like to thank our speaker, Dr. Shantal Aishram, for the nice talk. He has also shown a lot of open problems, which I think many of the participants may ponder about.
I'll try to give a proof, which, of course, is elementary. I hope everyone can understand, but I hope people didn't feel bored with the proof. But ideas, which one is to know, but I hope.
There are lots of comments in the comment section that the presentation has been liked by many of the participants. So I hope it's a very successful lecture. And over to Manjil again, if you want to say something.
From my side, everything is fine. So thank you very much, sir, for this very nice talk. Many people have said, given good feedback, and almost everyone is interested in getting the slides. So if you could
send to you, then you can upload.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. Have a